Deepfakes and fake news are destined to follow in the footsteps of email spam. They're going to be filtered out and no longer annoy us. We're going to see this problem move from something we have to fight against to something that will solve itself. Hi, I'm Amy James, the co-inventor of Open Index Protocol. Thanks for tuning in, and please hit that subscribe button. Welcome to the What Kind of Internet Do You Want series. This video is a deep dive into why problems like censorship, demonetization, and deepfakes are now happening, and how they are solved with cryptography and blockchain technology using an open source protocol. So give this video a like if you want to make the internet free again, and let's get into it. When we first began working on this project, we used a working title. We called the whole thing the Decentralized Library of Alexandria, as an homage, of course, to the ancient Library of Alexandria, because we wanted to create a place that could be a repository for all public information. At the first Decentralized Web Summit, the inventor of the web, Sir Tim Berners-Lee, told us that our technology was thrilling, but he also said that we really needed to change the name so that people could better understand what we were doing. And wow, he was so right. Giving the name Open Index Protocol to the technical specification that creates the system was an important milestone that helped our work be better understood. So we now call the browser application that we built to search all records on Open Index Protocol Alexandria to keep that connection and to signal that, like the ancient library, it's where you can go to search for all information. But the core of our work is the open source specification, which we sometimes also refer to as OIP. So the fundamental problem solved by Open Index Protocol is that the web doesn't have a public index. Problems like deplatforming, demonetization, and data mining are all symptoms of this single root problem. And I know it sounds sort of strange to say that the web doesn't have an index. It feels sort of off because we can search for things and we can find things on the web. The problem is that all of the indexes that we use right now are private. And as the world has been learning lately, they are not impartial. Without an open index, the future of information access on the internet is very frightening. We won't know which books are being metaphorically burned because we won't always be able to detect the censorship. When we started working on this 5 years ago, everyone said that the kinds of problems our technology is designed to fix were non-problems that would never happen. But now, everywhere you look, on social media, on TV, on YouTube, we see how urgently we need to upgrade the technical infrastructure of information and content distribution. So because the web doesn't have a public, permanent, and impartial index, censorship has become rampant. It's so obvious that everyone's talking about it. The news has been covering it. There have even been hearings in Washington. Because the web doesn't have a common, open, and universal index, creators aren't being fairly paid. Audiences are struggling to access content and resorting to piracy in frustration, and ad-monetized content is plagued with fraud. It's worth noting that this year in particular could be a major inflection point because, although it's true, everyone likes streaming content, the walled garden model is not sustainable, and the market is fracturing. Rights holders are pulling their content from existing services to create their own new walled garden platforms. You know, first we had Netflix and things were great. And then we got Hulu and Amazon and HBO Go and YouTube Red and Crackle and Comcast and DC Universe and CBS All Access and Fox Nation and Disney Plus and Apple Plus. It's getting crazy. And consumers are feeling forced into piracy because they can't have 20 separate streaming subscriptions to see all of the shows that they like. I mean, that's more than cable. I thought that cutting the cord was supposed to save us money. Because the web doesn't have a transparent, secure, and version-controlled index, it can be difficult to discern truth from fiction online, and the incentives between platforms, publishers, and audiences are misaligned. Deepfake videos freak me out, and with how quickly this technology is progressing, it feels like we're not going to be able to trust anything online in the future. And data mining has become so aggressive and creepy. My mom was just complaining to me that she'll talk about something out loud, and then the next time that she's on Facebook, she's served an ad for that exact product. It's creepy. In fact, we were getting ready for this shoot during this past week, and just this morning, I got served an ad for a product I had never seen before that is like an appliance to help me carry clothes into the set. I totally want this product now, but I just thought it was so crazy that they knew what I was doing and served me this product. Has something like that ever happened to you? If it has, write free the internet in the comments below or tell me the story of what random product showed up in your feed. Because the web doesn't have an open index, we've ended up in this walled garden model where if I'm an Apple Music user and you're a Spotify user, I can't share a playlist with you. And this is not how the web was supposed to be. The web was always intended to be fully decentralized. So way back when Sir Tim Berners-Lee was first creating the web in 1989 and 1990, everyone who participated ran it on their own personal computer. It was supposed to be fully decentralized. I love this photo of the first computer that was functioning as a web server, and that note that's torn off there, it says, you know, never turn this computer off, it's running the web. But since not everyone could run their own server to share a recipe or a video, private companies built the walled garden infrastructure that we have today so that the web could scale and be convenient for end users. Because when the web was developing in the early 90s, the technology didn't exist yet to build an index as an open standard protocol. So generally speaking, platforms like Google, YouTube, and Spotify aren't content creators, although all of a sudden everyone's becoming one to differentiate. I see you, Apple. These platforms offer a service to find and consume content. So one of the foundational services that they provide is indexing content and running private distribution networks so that their users can find and consume content. But because each of their indexes are private, information access on the web today can be censored. So even though the web was intended to be decentralized, this is what the web looks like today. It's a hub and spoke shape, and it's the hubs, or the central points of control, that limit our freedom. So some examples of how this affects us is that you and I cannot explicitly tell one of these services like Google how to index or tag our content. And when we publish commercial content to platforms like Spotify or YouTube, we don't get to determine the pricing or the terms of use. It's the platform that dictates these to the creator. The walled garden model is inconsistent, chaotic, and opaque. Don't get me wrong, the web is a wonderful place. But there is no great library absent a way to find what is in it. And right now, a handful of companies have the monopoly on the ability to do that. So I'm not saying that private companies don't have a role in the decentralized future. They provide very important services. What I am saying is that there are certain aspects about what they do that should function as utilities, namely indexing and distribution, and that these components should be open and public. Whereas services like search and discovery algorithms, well, those are proprietary and they should remain private. So this is how the problem is solved. The solution to the walled garden problem is a fully decentralized open protocol for indexing and distribution. The problem with walled garden private services like Google and iTunes is that they act as an artificial gatekeeper for how we can access content. Open index protocol replaces the private hub and spoke index and distribution infrastructure with a technical solution that is open source and fully decentralized. It is an index that is by, of, and for the people. I like to think of it kind of like the card catalog in a library, or maybe a phone book. But it's not just an index for phone numbers or for books, it's for all public data. We have partners using it for property records, for scientific data, of course for digital files like music, videos, and podcasts. Really, any data that is public and should be on the internet should be in the open index. So what you're seeing here is metadata published to the Flow blockchain. We'll talk more about the Flow blockchain later, but it's very similar to Bitcoin. So for now, let's just focus on the metadata of the record itself. And I'm going to highlight a few of the fields that we're going to talk about. So this is a record for a video of mine that was published. Like the card catalog in a library, records in the open index have basic metadata about the content, so the video title, the publisher name, and the address of the content. The record also has an ID number. You can think of this kind of like the Dewey Decimal call number. I've sometimes heard people worry that the size of the blockchain will become a problem after watching what's happened with Bitcoin, and that it doesn't make sense that we can distribute movies and other content because it won't be able to scale. But this isn't a problem for OIP because we're not putting the whole file in the blockchain. Think of this again like the library stacks. We put the card catalog like metadata, the name, the title, etc. That goes in the blockchain, and that includes the location for how to access the content. But the location, the content itself, it's located separately on a peer-to-peer network. So think of that like the stacks in the library. By limiting each component of technology to its intended use, we maximize the efficiency of the system. And because the records are kept in the blockchain, there is a public and version-controlled record of when content was published and who published it. And this information can be used to filter the content to solve problems of trust and authenticity. A good example of how this will improve things was that recent video of Speaker Pelosi that made it seem like she was drunk. High quality but transparent filters can increase the quality of information in our feeds, and therefore we hope the quality of the public debate. Because if that video had been published to the open index, well, we would have two key pieces of information that we don't have in the current system. The publisher would be cryptographically identifiable, as we just talked about, and when the content was published to the blockchain would be timestamped. Also, it's important to note that because machines are better at algorithmically detecting alterations and deepfakes and that kind of thing, they can be used to tag and filter content so that this fake stuff never even gets in our feed. But the key to all of this filtering is that because the master index of OIP is transparent, well, it's trivial to compare the master index to the filtered list. So I can know for sure that the filters are being used to increase the quality of my feed correctly and aren't being used for covert censorship. Deepfakes and fake news are destined to follow in the footsteps of email spam. They're going to be filtered out and no longer annoy us. We're going to see this problem move from something we have to fight against to something that will solve itself. Because with Open Index Protocol, it's not just easy to correct this problem, it's profitable for businesses to do it. Open Index Protocol is uncensorable and yet can follow the unique laws of each country. Whereas, if regulation is enacted to stop censorship in the current technical architecture, well, it will be very difficult to enforce because the system is so opaque. With Open Index Protocol, the ledger is transparent and it can be audited by anyone. The data, information, and content can then be filtered by the platforms according to their community norms and their business goals. Open Index Protocol is the technical solution to the problem of censorship on the internet. If you enjoyed this video, take a screenshot and share it out to let people know that you support freedom on the internet, and be sure to tag at Open Index Proto. You can also sign up for our newsletter at alexandria.io/newsletter and follow us on the social platforms that are linked below. If you found this video valuable, give it a like, make sure that you subscribe to the channel. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.